morning. Welcome to Cross Point Church. Let's stand up together. We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory. Yeah. Let's join. God who saves, we sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause He hung up on that cross and He rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. Let's join. Accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed.
His name is Jesus. His is freedom in his name. The healers in the room.
Amen. What a great day to be in the house of the Lord. Welcome to Cross Point Church, Bellaire, a City Rise campus. We're so grateful to be together with you and worship. And it's a great day just to be built into Christian community together. One of our greatest goals every week, beyond worshiping, beyond sharing the word, is just to build authentic community where we can grow in Christ together. One of the ways we do that is to just try to connect with each other. So if you are a recent first-time attender or today's your first day with us, there's a QR code on the seat back in front of you. You can scan it. There's actually a physical response card there if you want to fill it out, but it's a little dark for that. Do your best. Or you can go to cityrise.org/connect. This is all great ways that just to fill out a few bits of information and say, hey, I'm here. I want to know you guys better. I want to walk with you in ministry. How can we get to know you? On top of that, I just want to make you aware of a really excellent a tool we've provided for you for Easter. If you don't have the app already on your smart device, cityrise.org/app, you can go there and download it right away. But you can also follow this QR code, or you can go into the app itself, Bellaire Campus, and click Bulletin. One, you're going to find out all the pertinent information you need to know for this week, just like you would picking up the printed bulletin at the door. But this says salmon screen says there's an invitation. In a moment, everything can change. And if you scroll down just a little, it says copy and text this message. If I do that, it pre-populates a text message that you can fill in anybody's name to that invites them to Easter services next week. We wrote the text for you. We don't know who your friends are. So fill in the text, invite your friends and family, modify the text if you need to make it for you, but it's ready to go and then send. Next Sunday, we've got Easter services all morning long. I'll tell you more about that in a minute. We're going to transition right now to a time of worship through giving of tithes and offerings. So I'm going to invite our ushers to come forward and take your places to serve. As we worship, if you're one of those folks who are new, let your gift today be the gift of sharing your information so we can connect with you. Otherwise, let me pray. Let's give and worship. Father, we love you. We thank you. Truly, everything we do in this place is for your honor and glory. Help us to live out the power of your Holy Spirit in our lives so others can see and want to take part in the kingdom you provided through the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus. We thank you. In his name we pray. Amen. Let's keep worshiping.
So the next song that we're going to do is an older song, but it's one that I love, and there's so much rich theology in it. It's called Prepare You the Way, and as Kirby just mentioned, of course, it's Palm Sunday, and as I think about the preparations that were made for Jesus coming into the city, there was a donkey that someone had to provide for him. There were palm branches that people laid in the streets and waved in the air, and so as we think about this, as we prepare our hearts, there's work that we have to do within us. And as God's people, we are the heralds of his coming. We're the emissaries of his kingdom. And so let's join together as we sing this song to do that work together, to prepare our hearts and minds for not only worship and the taking of the elements of the Lord's Supper later, but also as we go into his world and we point people to Easter, we point people ultimately back to Christ and his coming again.
Prepare.
evening concerning his bride's great sin. He assured me we will be forgiven, and then let the marriage begin. Prepare ye the way for the Lord. Prepare ye the way for the kingdom. Prepare ye the way. Prepare ye the way for the Lord. Prepare.
I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
Waymaker.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You're my waymaker.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are.
Wait.
Good morning, everybody. Well, it sure is good to be here with you today. And if you're tuning in online right now, welcome. We're glad you're here today as well. Kirby may have mentioned this earlier, but we have the privilege of taking the Lord's Supper today. And so hopefully you're going to be preparing your hearts over the course of the message to do that. We're going to give you some space to do that as well. If you're at home, you can take a break and grab some elements at home and participate with us as well. But man, we're excited about that. We're excited about this series and how it continues to track along and the big theological, beautiful things that we're seeing in this Crux of the Cross series. We just love it, and we need to grab hold of this. We've talked about some of them previously, and today we're on number four, and it's just going to be awesome. I'm going to pray, and then we'll jump into our series. So I invite you to pray along with me this morning. God, thank you for the opportunity to be reminded of the beauty of the Palm Parade that happened thousands of years ago that still has relevance for us today, God. We're thankful for that day that Jesus rode into Jerusalem announcing his kingship and declaring just his godness over everything. Lord, we're so thankful for that. We all need it today too. And so I pray that as we look at this, that you would teach us and illuminate our hearts by the power of your Spirit to help all of us understand what the message is for us today. We love you, and we're so grateful to share this time under your authority today. And it's in Jesus' name we all pray together. Amen, amen. We are in the Crux of the Cross series, week number five. And as we get going today, I want to introduce you to a guy that I met by reading an article that highlighted him not long ago. His name is Koji Minami. Have anybody heard of Koji Minami before? He is an illustrator hailing from Seattle, Washington, and he is so talented. I read an article about Koji this past week and some of the things that he's accomplished, that he's done. He's just really incredible. I have no skills when it comes to illustration, so this guy really blows my mind with what he can do. But his design company asked him to do a project, and it was very interesting. Here's the project. He was to spend some time with a group of kids, and he would ask them one question and then draw what they described. Here was the question. He asked them this: what is the best way to describe God? So he got to sit with these kids. Let me share with you some of their descriptions. Ready for the first one? I call this guy Mr. Smarty Pants because he said, this should be easy for you because he's invisible. He went to private school, obviously. Another guy, he said he's a guy up in the clouds like on The Simpsons. Maybe so. Another kid said God has two heads, a round button nose, the body of a frog, and the head of a lion. I want to know what that kid had for breakfast. Like, I just don't even know. I mean, another one said he has a mohawk and he doesn't need to wear any clothes, including pants. Another one said he has big hands and he has large arms down at his side, ready to control all things in the universe. That's kind of interesting. One of the kids, after he had described, it may have been this one that talked about the body of a frog and the head of a lion, Koji actually showed him what he had described, and the kid's reaction was awesome. He said, "Oh man, what have I done?" And then he goes on to say, God may be angry with me right now. I am so sorry, God. Oh, it's funny, but truth be told, like, what, let's just ask you, what do you think? When you think about God, when you think about what you've learned about him, what you've heard about him, I wonder what you think God looks like. Stop for a minute. You know I'm on this kick right now of reading the Bible imaginatively. It's really changing the way I'm understanding Scripture in many ways. But just think about it. Use your imagination. What do you imagine God to look like? Colossians 1, 15 and 19, and Hebrews 1, 3 help us. Listen to this. Colossians 1 says, he is the image of the invisible God. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell. Hebrews 1:3, he is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. It's really difficult to describe what God looks like, isn't it? I mean, it's just hard. But here's the truth. And Colossians and Hebrews writers tell us this. If you want to know what God looks like, really the best place to start is to look at Jesus. If you want to know what God looks like, look at Jesus, because he is the image of the invisible God. He is the radiance and the exact imprint of his nature. What we're going to do today, here's the big idea, is to see that Jesus came to serve us by being God's revelation to the world. So far, we've seen how Jesus has served us throughout this series. And again, these are great theological truths. We've talked about how Jesus is our substitution. We use the HEB illustration for that. Sometimes when you grocery shop at HEB, they're out of a product and you're ordering online, they substitute. Sometimes you get the good toilet paper, sometimes you don't, right? We've talked about Jesus is the best substitution. He stood in our place for our sin. We also talked about this gift card, and this gift card represents this redemption theological truth that Robbie unpacked when he was here. Last week we talked about this ring and how this symbolizes reconciliation, and we looked at the prodigal son's story, and he had sinned heavily and mightily against his dad, and yet when he turned to come back home, what did he find? Did he find rejection? When he turned the corner and headed home, no, he found reconciliation. And the father said, take this family ring, put it on his finger. Because yeah, he sinned against me, but I can't wait to reconcile him, right? Today, we talk about God's revelation to the world. Jesus shows us who God is and what he's like. And so the symbol here, the picture are these binoculars, and they allow you to see things from far away that you just can't see up close. And that's what this narrative of this story that we're all familiar with today, this Palm Sunday story, helps us as Jesus walks this road to Jerusalem. It unpacks and helps illuminate at least three ways in which we see Jesus showing us who God to be. It's really beautiful. So let's dig into this and check it out right here. Here's the first way I want to show you how Jesus shows us who God to be. Here's the first one. God is the Savior who suffers. Jesus shows us in this narrative of the Palm Parade how God is the Savior who suffers. Look with me at the first verse of this narrative. It's in chapter 19 of Luke. We're just going to hit the first verse right here because this first verse is incredible. Luke tells us, and when he had said these things, he went on ahead, going up to where? Going up to Jerusalem. This is important. Very important. Just geographically, I find it interesting. He's coming out of Jericho, headed to Jerusalem. It's about a 15-mile journey between Jericho to Jerusalem, give or take a few miles, but there's a 3,400 increase in elevation, 3,400 foot elevation. So they're going up to Jerusalem on this intentional journey where Jesus would go through something. Again, Jerusalem is the key word here. You have your Bible and an ability to highlight this or underline it or do something to make that pop off the page there. This is significant because here's the deal. Jesus is not going on a vacation or like some incredible destination. That's not what's happening. Some of you guys just returned home from some incredible trips. I saw them online, and some of you guys went skiing and that looked amazing, and some of you guys went to a tropical place, and that looked amazing, and I'm working through my jealousy right now. I was here. It was really awesome. It was quiet. Traffic was calm, but you guys were having a great time. I'm glad you did, but Jesus was not going to one of those destinations. Jesus was actually going on a death trip. He was not going to a place where he would enjoy. kind of like me when I go camping. I hate camping. I'm sorry, I just do. Jim Gaffigan talks about camping, and he says, I don't know what the big deal about camping is. All the bugs are trying to move indoors. He goes on to say, I've never met a happy camper. Preach, Jim. Preach. Jerusalem, they're going from Jericho, making the way up to Jerusalem. Let me show you a few important things, all from Matthew's gospel. But he says in Matthew 16, 21, from that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. Matthew 17, as they were gathering in Galilee, second time Jesus has mentioned this to his friends, Jesus said to them, hey guys, the Son of Man is about to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him, and he will be raised on the third day. Third time, Matthew chapter 20, 17 and 18 says, and as Jesus was going up to Jerusalem, he took the 12 disciples aside, and he said, hey, listen up, we're going to Jerusalem. And the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death. Jesus knew exactly where he was going. And he did not try to get out of it. Isn't that interesting? He knew exactly where this road to Jerusalem would take him. He knew that he would be betrayed, he would be found guilty of a crime that he was innocent for, he would experience injustice, he would experience pain, betrayal, he would be crucified, he would be nailed to a cross, he would be placed into a borrowed tomb after he died, and yes, he would rise from the dead. He would go through all of those things, and he did not run from that. Isn't that incredible? He knew where Jerusalem would take him. And man, this is important because it shows us here Jesus' actions and Jesus' journey to Jerusalem shows us who God is. Jesus shows us that God is the Savior who suffers. He knew what was going to happen to him, and listen, he knew that it was necessary. Absolutely necessary that he die for the sins of the world. In this one verse right here, we see that God desires to rescue us. Now, I think this is really important. God doesn't just rescue us. God actually desires to do that. Jesus isn't going to Jerusalem rolling his eyes like, I guess I have to do this. Or frustrated because they can't get their act together. They can't seem to get this right. Why in the world can't they be better than this? That's not at all Jesus' demeanor walking towards this death sentence. No, Jesus is desiring to take our place. So God desires to rescue us, and God is determined to do whatever it takes, even die. Like, God will do whatever it takes to rescue us. And that meant his own death. The death of the Son that he sent. That's powerful. You know, as a dad, as a parent, I kind of get this a little bit. This resonates with me because when any of my children are going through something painful, as a parent, like, I want to stop the pain. Don't you? Like, when they're going through something hard, when they're going through something that's just so difficult and so painful, and you can see it in their eyes, and you can see it in their shoulders, you can see it in their face, you just see the crushing weight of sometimes how life washes over your children, you just want to step in and go, take it, you want to take it from them, right? And you just want to say, give the pain to me, and I'll carry that pain so they do not have to. Free them up. I may have shared this before, but my oldest daughter, Emma, was like, I don't know, 20 months old. I forget when you're supposed to stop counting months, like, and start calling children years. You know what I'm talking about? Like, I don't know the appropriate age to do that, but she was not old, maybe 20 months or so, and we had gone to visit some friends in Nebraska. And while getting ready for church one morning, she's toddling around the room and she picks up a hot curling iron. It was mine. I was curling my hair and, you know, my fault, totally. She picked it up. I've never heard a scream like that in my life. Hope I never have to again. We rush her to the emergency room. There's not much in Nebraska, but they do have emergency rooms there. Where we get there and the nurse says to my wife, you know, you probably shouldn't leave the curling iron. That went over really well. But the only way my daughter could get any relief was literally to toddle up and down the hallways of the emergency room, just pacing back and forth, screaming her head off. In that moment, all I wanted to do was take that pain from her and feel it myself and say, God, let her not feel this. Let me feel this instead. I will step into that. That's exactly the picture here. God desires to rescue us. That's who he is. It's what he's like. Jesus shows us that. And he's determined to do whatever it takes. It's beautiful. Let me ask you this. Do you know any suffering right now in your world? Like, is there some hard going on in your story right now? Some pain, some angst, some struggle? You know anyone that like is a part of their journey today? Here's the truth. God identifies with that and understands it because he himself has felt it. That's huge. God enters in to those times with us because he put himself there. Let me show you the second way that Jesus shows us what God is like. Here it is. Jesus shows us that God is the king over all. This is so good. Look at 19 again. Luke 19, verses 29 through 36. Luke continues to write, When he drew near to Bethpage at Bethany, at the mount that is called Olivet, he sent two of the disciples, saying, go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Untie it, bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you untying it? You shall say this, the Lord has need of it. So those who were sent away went and found it just as he had told them, and as they were untying the colt, its owners told them or said to them, why are you untying the colt? The Lord has need of it, they said, and they brought it to Jesus. And throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road. You've heard this story before, right? It's Palm Sunday, the Palm Parade. What I want to show you today is as Jesus is doing this, he's showing us that God is the king over all. He says to his friends, his boys, we're going up to Jerusalem. It's the death march. We're going to the cross. Don't be surprised. And here's how we're entering the city. Go grab the colt in the village. I'm going to sit on it. And I'm going to ride it into town, whereby I am announcing my kingship publicly to the world. I want people to know. I want people to see. Make no mistake about it. As Jesus is sitting on top of this colt, riding down Main Street, he's announcing his kingship. See, when kings back in this day, they ride horses. They ride high above other people to symbolize their dignity, to to make note of their importance and to also have protection. As Jesus rides in, he's showing that God is the king over all. I want you to look at Zechariah 9:9. Got it on the screen here, because as Jesus is riding into town, he's actually fulfilling a prophecy from Zechariah. It says this: "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he." Jesus fulfills this as he is just going down Main Street on this colt. Don't miss it. He knows exactly where the colt is. He knows exactly who it belongs to. He knows that it's tied up. He knows that people are going to ask questions. He knows, wait for it, Jesus knows all the details. And this shows us that he's the all-knowing king. If we read this too quickly, we kind of miss it. But Jesus is showing us that God is the king, but not just any old king. He is the all-knowing king. He knows all these details. Do you know all the details of your life? Of course not. Do you want to know all the details of your life? Probably not. Guess who does? Listen, God knows all the details in your life from beginning to end. Nothing surprises him, catches him off guard. He never says, "I didn't see that coming." He knows every question that you'll ask. He knows every need that you'll ever have. If you're anything like me, I am uncomfortable with unknowns. So what do you do when you live in a world of unknowns? You take comfort and rest in the all-knowing King. Aren't you glad God knows everything? There's probably some things in your life right now where you're like, "Man, I've got a decision to make here. I've got to do this thing. I don't know how this is going to turn out. I don't know what to do, right or left, straight. I just don't know." God knows. He's the all-knowing King. So good. Rest in his all-knowing capacities. Don't miss this, man. He's not only the all-knowing king, he's the all-powerful king. This is so cool. As I was reading this, I was reminded that Jesus knows ahead of time this colt has never been ridden. And he's going to parade down Main Street on this wild, untrained, unbroken animal. How do you think that's going to go? How do you think the colt is going to react when there's a crowd all around, like a crazy crowd who's throwing palm branches around, who are throwing fabrics around, like there is commotion all over the place? How do you think this colt, this animal, who's never experienced this before, is going to react and respond? If it's you, and if it's me riding it, not so well. The good news is the all-knowing king is also the all-powerful king, because he gets on top of that animal, rides it down Main Street without any issues whatsoever. People are all around. It's probably a little unnerving for this colt, but guess what? All things bow to submission to our God, right? And this is such a beautiful truth here, that Jesus, flesh and bone, God in the flesh, shows us that God is the all-powerful King. Here's another question for you. Is there any place in your life today where you need God's power to show up and show out? Do you need a miracle from God today? A moment from God to just give you a breakthrough? Jesus shows us that that is who God is. He's the all-knowing, all-powerful, all in control, all the time, King of Kings. Amen, right? that's you today, and you're like, yeah, I need God to move. Read this story. It's beautiful. Let me give you the last thing today. It's found in Luke 19, 37 and 38. Listen to this. So as he was drawing near, already on the way down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen. I mean, the crowd is going nuts. And here's what they say: blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Jesus shows us that God brings peace to our chaos. They could have shouted anything in the world here, but they chose to camp out on peace. Back to the animal. Notice Jesus tells his boys, go get the colt. This is how I'm walking into Jerusalem or riding into Jerusalem. Notice it was a colt. This is important because if you're a warrior king, guess what you're riding? You're riding a stallion. But Jesus chooses to announce what type of king he is, who God is, as he strolls down Main Street, not on a stallion, a warrior horse, but he's riding down Main Street on a donkey, on a colt. That's weird. That's odd. That's unique. That is him strategically and intentionally saying, I may not be the type of king that you anticipated. I'm coming and ushering in my kingdom, speaking to you that here's what God has for you and for all people. If they will look to me, I have peace. Oh, that's so good. Back to Zechariah's prophecy that Jesus fulfilled. Listen to the rest of it. 9 through 10. Behold, your king is coming to you, righteous and having salvation is he. Here's the rest of it. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey, he shall speak peace to the nations. That's so good. Jesus shows us that God is the one who brings peace to our chaos. Because peace is God's proclamation to people. Man, if you just do a quick tour of Scripture, we don't have time for this today. If you just do a quick tour of Scripture, you will see very quickly that peace is God's proclamation to people. Just go to the Christmas story. Yeah, I know it's Easter, but Christmas is always relevant. Amen? Right, kids? Christmas is... What did he say to Mary? She's freaking out. Peace. Joseph. He's freaking out. What does he say to Joseph? Peace. The shepherds. They're certainly freaking out. They've never seen anything like this before. What does he say to the shepherds? Don't be afraid. Peace. Zechariah and Elizabeth. Peace. Guess what he says to you? Peace. He says the same to me. Peace. Do you have any chaos in your life? Do you have any chaos in your life? Does your life look like your bracket right now? Mine is blown up. Where in your life do you need peace? Relationally, spiritually, physically, mentally, financially? I probably missed something there, but here's the deal. Don't miss what Jesus shows in the Palm Parade narrative. God shows up in your world, and he is not looking to shame you. He's looking at you and has one word for you. Hey, peace. Peace. You want to know what God looks like? He's the Savior who suffers. He's the King of all. He is the one who brings peace to chaos. Isn't he good? He's good. We're going to respond this morning through the Lord's Supper. And so if you are a follower of Jesus, you are welcome to come to the table. Our band is going to come up, and as they come, we're going to have our deacons come down front as well, and they're going to begin to pass out the Lord's Supper elements. And as you receive the elements, we want you to prepare your heart to participate in the Lord's Supper. Remind your own heart during this song that peace is possible, that there's a King over all, that he has come to suffer for you by sending his Son in your place. So prepare your heart through this right now. And then Kirby will come back and lead us to take this Lord's Supper together. I'm going to pray as we begin this. Lord, thank you so much for this beautiful truth in the Word today. We pray, God, that we would continue to see you beautiful and good and amazing. We celebrate the Lord's Supper today. We just don't take it. We celebrate it because of who you are and what you've done for us on the cross and in the resurrection. As we usher in Holy Week this week, God, I pray that today just is a beautiful opportunity for us to resonate with all the events that have taken place, culminating in the celebration of the empty tomb. We pray in Jesus' name.
Body broken for the body of his bride. There stretched upon the timber what pierced hands and feet. His flesh to death surrendered. The flesh was now we eat. The bread of life, the body and the blood, the living offered unto us the gift of hope for all who believe to take and receive. In this we do remember, in this we do proclaim the covenant that binds us by his death and by his name. And that which flowed on Calvary from the wounds of one so meek is the spring of life eternal, the spring which now we drink. The bread of life, the body and the blood, the the gift of hope for all who believe, to take and receive, to take and receive. Justified, our wandering hearts recovered, reconciled to God and one another. Bread of life, the living Christ, the gift of hope for all who believe. The bread to take and receive, to take and receive, to take and receive.
You can remain standing if you like. Paul's writing to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, and he's writing about their unity. He's saying, look, standing unity, I hear there are factions among you, and those are necessary because it points out who's really trying to do this with peace. It points out when there are factions, it points out who's really trying to follow. That's an interesting thought, isn't it? But he's drawing us to unity in the body and in the person of Jesus as he says to them, and Paul writes, for I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So open the side of the cup that has the bread, and let's take it in his remembrance. Likewise, he also took the cup after supper. He said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Amen. We've built in this week a series of services and events to keep drawing attention to what Christ has done. This Thursday night, Maundy Thursday, at 7 p.m., there'll be a service of remembrance at the West U campus from 7 to 8. It'll be live streamed, but it'll be live at West U, so come and partake. Prepare your heart for Easter as we meet together and worship. Saturday, it's a whole different level. At Evelyn's Park, gathering for an Easter egg hunt. We are not dropping eggs out of a helicopter, but it's just about that crazy. So come help. Come bring your kids, your grandkids, invite your neighbors. Super fun and just a great way to gather and celebrate the life of Jesus and the community of faith. And the next Sunday morning, Easter, there will be three services right here, 8 a.m., 9:30, and 11 a.m. No community groups, just tons of celebration through worship next Sunday morning. And don't forget, in the weekly bulletin, there in your app, you can open up that preformed text and just send it to the people you know and love that need what you already know and have. Let's share Jesus and come ready. Let me pray for us, and as we conclude, if you've never done so before, come connect with Chris in guest reception right out these double doors. Let me pray. Father, we love you. We thank you. We do take and receive your body and your blood. We take in the message of your peace, the reconciliation you gave on the cross, and the revelation that we look out to see that you are the one who embodies the very presence of God. Well, we go out to live it in your name. We pray that it will be evident in our lives and that others will be drawn to you because of the testimony they see in us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless the rest of your day.